What's up, everybody? Today, I am going to share my thoughts on the cheapest military-grade knives that you can get. These are called military-grade because they're designed, I guess, expecting the military to buy them. Because guess what? They sell them at the military base because that's where I got them. So, let's begin. All right, the first knife that we're going to review is this knife called Buck Solo. It is a traditional knife, and I love this knife. I mean, the thing about traditional knife is the craftsmanship, I think, goes further than pretty much any other modern pocket knives. And oh, if you just hold it and use it, it just feels like you're part of history, you know? I mean, there's just something, especially when you're holding a buck knife, because buck has been such a name. Buck knives have put, you know, made their mark in history, so to speak. Some people call it as your grandfather's knife, but who cares about that, to be honest, unless you have buck knives that have been passed down. I gotta say, though, this is a tiny, tiny knife. For comparison, let me take out the Buck Hunter, the classic 110 design here. It's just tiny. It's a 2-inch, even though it says a 2-inch clip point design with 420 J2 steel, I don't know. I had other 2-inch knives and it doesn't feel this tiny, especially compared to its grandfather, if you will. One day sometime soon we will talk about this knife. Now, obviously, because it's a, you know, tiny compact knife, you're not going to do anything crazy with it. And it's a slip joint, so you're definitely not going to do anything like you would do on any kind of fixed blade. But you can do all the tasks that you need to do with it in terms of, like, you know, opening packages. It does that really well. You know, boxes, all the normal utilitarian work stuff, this will be great for. This wood feels really, really nice. I mean, the only real disappointment other than the size for me is, man, if you're getting a buck knife, you expect buck. Let me show you what my disappointment is. That's not a deal breaker, but still a disappointment. It's made in China. But see, the thing is, when you buy a buck knife, you expect a solid, you know, USA built pride, you know, a knife. But so it's a little disappointing that when you purchase a buck, that it's China, you know? Now, having said that, I don't think Buck would put their name on something that's poor quality. And you know what? If it didn't have the China logo on there, I might not even tell the difference. Because while you can tell it is a cheaper knife, it's crazy. It feels really, really nice. And very functional. $12. If you want a military-grade Buck knife that is still affordable, I gotta show you this guy. This is the Buck Bantam Cryptek Typhoon Camo. It is quite the mouthful. I keep looking at my director over there, who is my fiance. This is a $22 knife, and it is made in USA. That's right, $22 knife made in USA. 420 drop point steel, slightly over 3 inches. The pattern reminds me of a crocodile skin pattern, so to speak, although you can't really see much. And there's a bit of a stone-like pattern here, but you can tell it's basically plastic. I don't think it's a G10 handle at all. For some reason, if there's resistance here, it's basically pretty resistant to opening. So even though it has a thumb thing here, and you can force open it, and I have tiny hands, so I have trouble doing it, but it's so difficult to do. It is definitely not a one-hand easy open, you could, and not a one-hand close, obviously, because of the lock. So if you don't mind that, then sure. The pocket clip, in my opinion, is on the wrong side. Another thing that I don't like about this knife is it feels cheap. I don't know why, but the texture feels, it feels like a toy, unfortunately. It feels like something you will get playing war at a toy. I mean, it's a real blade, so there is that. But other than that, it just feels so flimsy. It feels I mean, there is a bit of blade play. It's just not a confident knife. And it is $22, so I will give them that. But for $22 being sold with a buck name at a military base, I expected a better feeling knife in terms of filling me with confidence. But then again, it is a buck. It does have an ergonomic fit in my grip. Does have a jimping. Interestingly enough, not in the blade. The jimping is actually in the handle. The handle protrudes out more than the blade itself, and it's weird, but it's there. Super light though, and just a weird knife. All right, let's go to the next one. Again, Buck Solo. I think I would rather have the Buck Solo. The next knife I have here is the Gerver Evo Junior knife. So, the interesting thing is it has a flipper, but it doesn't really flip all the way. I almost never get it to flip all the way, but it does have the thumb stub and you can just finish it. So it is possible to do one step. It is possible to do one hand open, therefore, but it's a two-step, one step open. And I think a lot of flipper knives kind of know that's how it's going to open some of the time. This one is every time. And what's weird about this knife is that it has jimping on the lock, but it's so close to the handle that you can barely, you have to use your whole thumb. Ow. There it is. See, you have to use your whole thumb to be able to close it. If you're like me, it's a two-step process. It's really not possible to close it without two hands, at least safely, in my opinion. And it's, despite adjusting this, it's really tough to engage. However, I gotta say, once it snaps in, it is a solid feeling knife for for the tiny thing it is. I mean, I feel like there's no blade play. There's slight blade play, but almost subtle. And the metal handle and everything, it's actually a really, really decent knife. It's actually a really, really decent feel. And it feels solid. Like, it has a little bit of weight to it, despite Gerber claiming that this is the lightest knife they've ever made. Or at least, I guess, right now in production. So, has a slight jimping even. Once again, in my opinion, the clip is here, you know. But, wow. I don't know where to go with that in terms of... But I would say this is a $13 knife. And for $13, it is an excellent knife. A little frustrating and get it to in terms of opening and closing, which is, I suppose, some people buy knives just for that to fidget around with. So if that's the case, this is not for you. But if you are really okay with, I think, if you're really okay with this 7CR 17 MOV blade, which is good, I think for a $13 knife, then this is a knife for you. The clip is in the way, but I feel like it kind of adds to the grip. I would say this is an excellent choice for anybody. Well, for $13, it's a good one. So next we have the Smith & Wesson Little Pal. This is a $9 knife at the exchange. Now, I don't know why it is. Let me show you what this is first. Apparently, this is a 7CR 17 MOV steel. For $9, it's a little over 2 inches. It's 2.3 inches or something like that. It's 2.25 inches. This thing is tiny. It's small. It's almost impractically small. I mean, it's tiny. And the thing is, obviously at this point, it's not designed for heavy use. So I don't know what it's designed for really. It has thumb stubs. I don't know why. You can't open this. It's too... you can't open this one-handed. It's just too small. It's just not going to work. I guess it's for a child, maybe? I don't know. I don't even know if the child has dexterity to do that. It is a frame lock, right? But even with just two-hand opening, it has its challenges, you know? Maybe it's not a thumb stub. Maybe that's just a thing. Maybe it's designed for the second hand to grip it. Because without it, I suppose you have to... really pull that out. It's really stiff. And the whole knife, It feels, I don't know if you hearing this makes a difference, but it feels like a tin can, to be honest with you. I feel like I'm going to break this thing. Like a little bit of pry, it's going to snap off or something. Or I know a lot of knives will damage when you step on them, especially the pocket knives. But I feel like this thing would just bend and snap. Just the handle will do that or something. It is a useful box cutter, but it's a two-handed operation all the way. There's no way anything can be done with just one hand. So even if it's a $9 knife, unless you are just looking for stocking stuffers or something that you're just looking to give out, no reason. Unless you are trying to use this only to like cut open boxes or something, no reason to get this. I just don't like it. It's worthless, to be honest. I would not recommend this to anybody. Yeah, it has a laughable jimping way over here. So I have to, how am I supposed to jimp it? I mean, how am I supposed to grip it? It's a ridiculous knife. It's a little pal. Huh, okay. Now, since we're on the, in the topic of Smith & Wesson here, I gotta show you this. This is the extreme of Smith & Wesson. And it is a two-step open, I would say. Although I'm sure some of the better flippers out there will be able to flick it open like that. It's a little tricky to do. But if you're not comfortable with it, it does flip. And then, you know, easily open that way, two steps. But this is the extreme opposite. It's a serrated version. And I gotta say, for a $13 knife, because that's how much this costs, it's an amazing deal. If you're trying to buy like a first knife for somebody, I will recommend this one. If they lose it, it's $13. If they break it, it's $13. But it seems like a solid knife. I mean, if there was no logo on here, I would have thought this was a $40 knife. It has good, comfortable jimping here. It has good, comfortable jimping here. Has a pretty darn good grip. It feels smooth. So it does have the slippery feature to it. Although the thumb grip here has a bit of a grip. But it is a solid performing knife. It's just, I like this one. This one was not at the exchange when I bought it, but I bought them online. But it's Extreme Ops by Smith & Wesson. Great $13 knife. I mean, nothing to complain about for $13. This is amazing. You'd be able to get legitimate work out of this thing. And the last knife that I have here is the K-Bar Warthog. And this knife was $18, and I will tell you this right now. This feels solid. Oh my gosh. It feels like a heavy user. I wouldn't use it for something too heavy, obviously, because it's an $18 knife, as well as a 3CR 13 MOV steel. So not something to write home about. It is a Tanto design, but it has a G10 scale. It's pretty heavy. And it's textured, grippy, tactical almost. It's a one-hand open. In fact, this is the smoothest one-hand close and one-hand open. If you are a thumb flipper better than I am, you'd be able to do this very easily. I just need to do the wrist flick because I suck at it. So, good grip. This part here is really, really weird. And I was concerned that when I close this thing and then it, you know, landed on my hand once it closes, it would cut my hand open. But actually, the way it's designed, it hit my nail several times. And it's a great design. It works. It protects your hand. So, I mean, for $18, this is a knife I think people should actually use. And the thing is, it's K-Bar. K-Bar is the one that makes, well, the K-Bar, you know, the Bowie knife. And that was used during the World War II. So these guys know knives and these guys know military. So when I saw this, I had to get it. $18 K-Bar. What would it feel like? What would it look like? How would it, you know, definitely not the best in terms of like, it doesn't feel like a high-end knife, but it feels like a solid worker. I mean, if someone handed me this knife, I had to guess the knife without knowing the steel, I would have guessed maybe $40 here as well. I mean, it's, or even $50 because of the weight. I would have thought it was made of something solid and it had a G10 scale. And you know what? It is smooth, you know? for $18 knife, it functions like a normal knife. I have yet to find a way to not bounce this on my nail though, but it works pretty darn well. Maybe if I just went this, nope. I guess that's why they designed it that way. But dude, I say this is absolutely probably, I would say, the first actual military grade knife that you can get cheap. This is the one I think I would recommend anybody for $20 if they're looking for a nice, almost a heavy use, a nice folder that's considered to be carried in the military that you're going to use more than opening boxes for, but not like batoning, obviously. But this would be the one I would recommend. I mean, this is excellent. They do have one with non-serration, but they are all Tanto. Again, this is a K-Bar Warhawk 2. $18. You can't go wrong with this. It's really hard to find any downside for this. A bit, I mean, other than it's slightly tricky to learn. It is a weird radius opening. So it is a learning curve, but I think you'll learn it pretty quick. So there you have it, everybody. These were all bought off in base, and most of them are less than $20. I think the buck is the only one that I mentioned that's more than 20. Out of all of these, the ones that I like are this Smith & Wesson Extreme Op editions, not the Little Pal. I like the Gerber Evo Jr. It's okay, I would say, rather than I like or love it. But I like it enough to say it's okay. It's pretty good. But the K-Bar Warhawk, oh man. This is a knife that is a lot of knife for less than $20. So, yeah. And obviously, if you buy this off at the military store, they're all tax-free. So, all right, guys. Thank you for watching this far. I'm guessing if you watched it up to this point, whether this was a good video or a bad video, there has been some contribution, I think, and knowledge for all the interweb out there. So, please like or subscribe to my channel because that's really cool to see. And if you guys have any comments, it'll be great if you guys left non-offensive comments because I'm just doing this for fun and hobby. So if you guys have any questions or comments or tips, actually, that'd be great. All right, guys. See you guys next time. So bye.